It's time for a project, and the project isn't going to involve these circuit boards that I got from GLC-PCB. However, I want to clear once again, they are not a sponsor. I don't accept their free offer of circuit boards. I always pay for them. And it turned out to be very interesting because their $2 offer does not always work out at $2, particularly in this one where, well, let's talk about that in a moment. This is a 5x5 array of little circuit boards that are designed as an alternative to previous projects where I've taken the strings of battery-operated Christmas lights and I've shown that you, how you can sleeve and solder resistors in after you've chopped USB leads off just to use them as a USB connector. I thought it'd be really cool to make a circuit board where you can actually just plug the USB lead as it is onto the circuit board and it's got the resistors and the connector and it's just a little interface that lets you connect straight to the lights. So this is the first time I've had them panelized and with the V-score. And the V-score means that you can just basically, you can flex it and they will cut, crack along a line and then you can break it down further into the individual circuit boards. And it's interesting to note, I'd seen other YouTubers that shilled the GLC-PCB services. And one in particular was saying, here's how many you can get for your $2. You can panelize it with a V-score to lots and lots of tiny circuit boards. And he was getting loads and loads of circuit boards for the $2 offer. It doesn't work like that if you're paying for them. This circuit board here, a set of five of these, with the extra tooling cost, the engineering cost for the V-score and things like that, actually came into $7.10 plus shipping. That's fine. That's perfectly acceptable. This one, however, this is for a later project based on a Russian lighting effect, and it's lots of tiny circuit boards. Not only did it incur the extra charges for the V-scoring, but because the circuit boards are so thin, that involves more manual effort. So this set of five circuit boards came in at $23.30 plus shipping, so it came close to about $30, maybe just slightly over $30 for this set of five circuit boards. The other YouTuber did not really imply that that would happen, so it's useful to pay for them and get the same service as everybody else. But anyway, let's make this circuit board. So this has two 10-ohm resistors. I'm going to zoom down in this. It has two 10-ohm resistors, it has an output connector and a little micro USB connector. It's worth mentioning, I went for thinner circuit board here, material here. So here is the calipers, and this material is 1.2 millimeters thick, as opposed to the usual 1.6 millimeter thick material. And the reason I chose that is because I got some of these little connectors from AliExpress and eBay, different sources. And although they all look the same in the listings, I should scroll out of it here. Although they look the same in the listings, the length of the pins and the legs can be very variable. So I deliberately, this one was the shortest, so I deliberately designed it to actually accommodate this little tiny connector. I like these. These are micro USB connectors, but they've got just two pins at the back. It just makes them much easier to solder than the surface mount ones with all the tiny pins. These ones can actually be put through a hole and soldered easily. Right, let's get back down and start soldering this together and see if it works. I mean, it should work. It's only two resistors in series. One the positive rail, one the negative rail. Why two resistors? Just to spread the load. It means that if you're running them at fairly high current with low value resistors, they're not going to risk getting the resistors exceeding their rating. Notice the screen print looks a bit scruffy there. It's definitely a bit patchy there as well. That's okay. It occasionally happens. It's not that critical. I wonder if I'd been getting them as a freebie, if they'd actually done special service and given, you know, taken things like that into consideration. Who knows? Right. That's the two 10-ohm resistors, which I'm just forming by hand. Now let's solder them in. Where is the solder? There's the solder. As usual, I'm just going to hold them in with my fingers at the back while feeding the solder in. So we'll start off with this one. As always, when soldering, make sure you've got a nice, clean, I like to tin it before use, bit. It should be shiny, it shouldn't be matte. And apply the soldering iron tip to the pad and the lead and then put the solder into it. That way, that vapor that's coming off is the flux. It's quite important that that boils off while you're actually making the solder joint, because it's the flux that mates them together. This is very hot, actually, because me holding resistors in, but that's okay. If you do what some people do and you put the solder onto the iron and then you take it across and try and wave it off onto the joint, that's how you get bad joints, because the flux is all gone by that point. Right, tell you what, let's do this. Oh, that's getting very hot very quickly. Ow, 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 ow. Tiny circuit board. That is the peril of tiny circuit boards. Now we can just grip it from the side, so this is going to be a lot easier. So on goes the other solder connection. At the end of that resistor, and this one for the end of this resistor. Okay. They look okay. They look fine. They look excellent. Maybe I'm exaggerated by saying excellent. We'll crop those off with these generic side cutters from eBay. Electronic side cutters, lowest price first on eBay. They're so commonly used in China that they're all pretty good quality. Get yourself a couple of pairs. They're very, very useful. Now I'm going to put in, oh, I forgot a component actually, not to worry, I shall go and fetch it in a moment. Now we'll put in this little connector here, which, true to form, it's goes in a friction fit, but it's only protruding through a tiny little bit. That's annoying, but that's okay. It's enough to solder, which is the main thing. That's why I went for the thinner circuit board. Maybe I should have gone for a 1 millimeter thick circuit board, but as it is, I can solder it. And that's all that's really needed. It's very random, these connectors, what you actually get. They're kind of a specialist connector, the little micro USB 2-pin through hole. It's not normally used by companies. That is the connector on. It looks quite smart. Right, now for the little other connector, which is going to mate onto the Molexi type connector. One more, I'm just going to grab that. There we go. Oh, there is a bug in my drawer. There is a bug in my drawer. It's actually found its way into the drawer. That's quite annoying. I shall get rid of that bug later. Now, this is where this connector goes on with a little alignment and latching. Well, it's more for alignment. It doesn't really latch at the back here. And it's something I didn't really think of. I measured these pins sideways and then put a round hole, and it fits. It's a nice friction fit. It's a very snug fit. But in hindsight, I should have measured those holes diagonally, because that's the largest diameter, so to speak, of a square pin. Okay, and now we'll solder this in. This is so easy to make. You could, if you're making up a few of these, just do them on the panel before actually snapping them apart. In hindsight, you know that thing that you submit the circuit board for manufacturing and you suddenly realise what I could have done? I could have moved that little symbol up there, that one up there. I could have put great big pads here, and you could have soldered these leads directly onto the circuit board. It would be like a little current limiting adapter. But I didn't think of that. Not to worry. So this is it. A USB cable can now physically plug into this circuit board, and then it has the current limiting resistors, and then it puts out on this connector. So now we bring in the lights, and this time I'm going to be featuring George Home. These are very nice. These are from a supermarket in the UK called Asda. And the nice thing about the string lights is they're pink, purple and blue. That's really nice. It's a good colour. So let's get rid of this huge, ugly label. We'll just cut this off completely. And the child safe battery box with screws in it. How annoying. So let's crop these at an even length. And I shall strip them using this generic pair of cheap wire strippers. These ones are made by Draper. NO.WS6. I presume that's the model number. They're just generic wire strippers. And now let's check the polarity. So to check the polarity, I recommend just getting a lithium button cell, hold the wires on either side. If they light, as they are, then the wire that is in the big side, the positive side, is the positive. I'm going to put a wee red dot in that. I'm going to get a Sharpie, and I'm just going to put a wee sploot of red on it. That is the positive. Now, I'm going to handle that before the Sharpie has dried and get red ink all over my fingers. This is where the project suddenly gets very expensive, but there's other options. You can solder into these little crimps. Now, the connector I'm using is typically called, its online name is a KF2510. KF2510. Very common connector. I really like these connectors. I've used them a lot. I probably started using them because with Rapid Electronics, it was probably the most affordable little circuit board connector they had. And at the time, this crimping tool wasn't that cheap, but still affordable compared to the official type tools. I really desperately want to twist these wires together before putting them in, but you can't do that with crimps because these little crimps actually have wings that fold round like the McDonald's M and actually the McGolden arches, and they crimp into the wires and they part them into two little clusters. If you twist them together, it interferes with that and it can actually cut some strands. It's very hard getting out of the habit of doing though. I did it so long. I never really had problems. But hey, you know what? I'll do it the proper way. I'll be a pro. In goes this crimp. When you first start crimping things like this, the first ones are pretty tricky until you get used to it. And then it's plain sailing. And you can I'm going to mess it up now, aren't I? But it's plain sailing after that, once you've got used to them and you can make the crimps quite easily. Now, traditionally, I would usually put the positive, which is marked red, in here, and the negative in here. I've just put that set of crimps on top of something making creaking and sliding noises. That is it. Let's try our system out. So here's a little USB power bank. You could use a plug-in USB power supply. Is it going to work? Let's zoom out here. It could be a disaster. It could just not work. I chose the two 10-ohm resistors just because that's a good value for a typical current limiting option. There it is. In hindsight, it might be an idea to use the right angle connector, but this is it. It's doing the job, and they do look bright. They look pretty damn good, actually. Nice colours. What is the current flowing through those? If you want to know the current flowing through a circuit without actually putting the meter, when you put the meter in line, it adds a resistance in this current range. There's a way to measure the current through resistors just by measuring the voltage across them. So these are 10 ohm resistors. By measuring the voltage across them, I'm going to turn this down to the 2 volt range. By measuring the voltage across a 10 ohm resistor, it is 1.06 volts. You can work out the current through it. I equals V, 1.06 volts. Divided by the 10 ohm resistor equals 106 milliamps is flowing through that circuit. That, if you've got a very low voltage differential, sometimes particularly in the low current ranges, the meters, their internal resistor can actually add enough resistance to actually seriously affect the current. So whereas I measured, well, let's try that. Let's see what, the meter measures. If I just unplug this and I'll just make a little adapter up right now and we'll put the meter in series, we'll see if it comes anywhere close to that. One moment, please. And continue. So putting this little dinky meter in, set to the 200 milliamp range, it has skewed the reading by about 5 milliamps, so it's showing 100.9 milliamps. Now let's put in the original meter that measured about 106 milliamps, if I remember correctly. So I shall plug this into the comm, I shall plug this into the microamp milliamp, I shall turn it round to DC 200 milliamps, and I shall inject the meter in series after tightening up these leads. I could actually put the crocodile clips on, but I'm not going to. What's this going to do? It says 88.6 milliamps. That's just being affected completely by the value of the resistor inside different meters. So the most accurate way is to measure across one of the resistors in circuit. It's also very easy, and it will give a really accurate current indication. Current lead out, remembering that the current connections are pretty much a dead short circuit over to COM, apart from that resistor. Always go back to your normal voltage reading settings. So that is it. The project is complete. I'm just going to put this meter down, then come back over to where the microphone is. Then I'm going to pull that out there, and just stuff this connector on here and restore the marvellous Asda Christmas light glory. But now running from a USB power bank or a plug-in USB adapter, you don't have to worry about the batteries. This little circuit board takes a standard USB lead and lets you either run them from the power bank or a plug-in power adapter without worrying about the batteries at all. And there's 20 LEDs here, that say 100 milliamps. For the 20 LEDs, that works out about 5 milliamps each. That's a fairly decent brightness, but that this will run like 100 LEDs at say 1 milliamp, which is usually still quite bright as well. But there we go, project complete. I think that worked out quite nice. It's a very neat little circuit board, and it's very easy to build.